Hello, I'm Frank Hutchison, and today we're going to be discussing the world's oldest inn, founded in 705.
Some background on the founder of the inn. The founder, Fujiwara Mahito, was the son of a huge political figure during the Asuka period. His name was Fujiwara Kamatari. He met the future emperor when he was a young prince, and they made friends, totally in a random coincidence. And this was a time period of a lot of warring and a lot of conflict. Buddhism and Chinese theology and philosophy were kind of pushing over and taking over Japan at the time. Part of what Fujiwara no Kamatari did with the future emperor, Tenji, is they worked on what was called the Taika reform, where they took Japanese law and they codified it, really for the first time, and included the best parts of Chinese law with the new innovations that Japan was using. They also ensured that Buddhism didn't take over Japan. They emphasized Shintoism, which really identified Japanese culture as separate from Chinese culture. He's credited with creating the strong imperial system that lasted for more than a millennia. Right before he died, the emperor gave him the surname Fujiwara, and he was the founder of this clan. It's a pretty big deal clan. In fact, they're referred to, this clan went down and eventually created what are called the Five Regent Houses, because his oldest sons had children and more children, and all of them, they had close ties to the emperor's family. They kept getting married to the emperor's children. For more than a millennium, the imperial princesses were married to Fujiwara lords. But there's a younger son, Fujiwara Mahito, and younger sons didn't always get the best deals because the higher up you were in age, just like in other areas, the more precedence you get. So what's a younger son to do? Well, he went back to their home prefecture, which was, let me make sure I'm pronouncing this correctly, Yamanashi Prefecture. That's where Mount Fuji is. It's where some of the most beautiful mountains are in Japan. It's also far down towards the south, so it's where the majority of fruit and wine are produced. It's where you're going to find plums and peaches and grapes in Japan, and people loved going there because there are a lot of rivers, there are a lot of hot springs, the sacred mountain is there, so it had a lot of pilgrimages and shrines in the area, and also the water in the hot spring where this inn is very unique. It has four very specific minerals because it comes from four different sources that combine together and are considered extremely healthy and very low acidity, so people wanted to come there. So he went there and he used his family's money and he set up an inn, which is pretty brilliant when you consider the location. Partly due to his political connections and the location, this inn attracted the celebrities of Japan for more than a millennium. Tokugawa Ieyasu, who was the very first shogun of Japan, went there. The emperors visited, military officers, artists, samurais, they all came. If they were going to come down and visit this area with the best food and wine and these shrines and beautiful, beautiful scenery and Mount Fuji, which is so important to Japanese culture, they were going to stay at Nishiyama Onsen Keiunkan. So you have this really critical connection between celebrity and culture, but what's also really interesting is that they didn't survive just on the celebrities coming to visit. The locals ate there too. In fact, really their survival, their stability was based on winning over the local population and being accessible to them as well. I mean, you hear all the time, I was just reading about in Cuba, how the restaurants that tourists frequent are not affordable to the residents in Cuba. So you have the stratification. The locals eat one place, the tourists eat another place. That was not the case for this hotel and restaurant. If you came there, if you lived there, you could afford it. Anyone could reach it. Anyone was accessible.
If you'd like to learn more about the subject that we discussed today, you can find multimedia content, links to articles we discussed, and videos on our website at www.hiddenhistoryofbusiness.com. You can also find us on Facebook as The Hidden History of Business and on Twitter as well. Thanks for listening.